Now, this morning, we're looking at the book of Esther. You know, we've got a thing to follow here. So this morning, we're going to be looking at the book of Esther. But before I get to that, I wanted to give a footnote to the comments I made last week about the benefits of scholarship and the need to take advantage of scholarly labor, something I feel very strongly about. A brother who agrees with that general assessment, he thought it would be helpful, though, to point out that scholarly opinions not to be confused with the Word of God. And that's certainly true. I mean, scholars are just fallible, sinful human beings, as are all teachers. They're not inspired men and women, and they therefore can be and often are wrong. So no one should mistake scholars for prophets. And they need to be, scholars need to be read with some discernment. In other words, you need to separate the meat from the bones, as is commonly said. Now, that may be more challenging for a younger Christian, but I think the solution to that is that you need to look at the facts and the reasoning behind conclusions, not simply say, this is a scholar who has this opinion. You see, I'm thinking especially now in commentaries and when you're dealing with the text. So you have somebody here, you want to know why does he think that, and then read broadly so you read other people who will raise other questions and issues, and I think that's the best way of handling that. So, you know, read broadly, read critically, and then use scholarship because it's important. Okay, now you'll recall we're going to be talking about Esther today, but I want to remind you of where we are. I keep saying this. I know you may get tired of it, but some of these things, there's a certain amount of chronology that every Christian ought to have. Every Christian ought to have certain pegs in the flow of history, and so I'm trying to reinforce those. And you recall that the United Kingdom of Israel, it divided into the two separate kingdoms, Israel to the north, Judah to the south, at Solomon's death, as prophesied. Solomon, you know, because of how he had lived, God was going to do this. So at Solomon's death is 931, some would put it at 930. So then you have the division of the kingdoms, and the northern kingdom of Israel, it lasts for a little over 200 years, and it's finally vanquished by the Assyrians, who were the dominant world power of that time, at that time, in 722, 721, when they finish Israel by conquering Samaria, the capital city there. Now, the southern kingdom of Judah, so that's in 722, 721, Israel to the north is gone. The southern kingdom of Judah continues in existence down until you have the exiles by the Babylonians, who have now come in the place of the Assyrians as the dominant world power. And you have three exiles, basically. You have 605, Daniel goes out. 598, 597 is a large exile. That's when Ezekiel goes into captivity. But then you have really the culmination. In 587, 586, Nebuchadnezzar comes back. And this time he destroys Jerusalem, the city and the temple. So that's when the Babylonians, the Jews, are. That's the final stage of their going into exile. Then the Persians, here's this little chart that I put up last week. The Persians, in keeping again with prophecy, in fact, prophecy named Cyrus. Named Cyrus, that God's going to raise up Cyrus, the Persian, he's going to come. And in keeping with that prophecy, they displaced the Babylonians as the dominant world power in 539 BC, when a Mede-Persian alliance that was led by Cyrus conquered the capital city of Babylon. And so in 539, that's kind of the defining moment. That's when the Persians now become the dominant world power. And sometime in 538, probably, Cyrus issued a decree permitting the Jewish people to return to their homeland. You have to recognize how amazing that is. You see, we know that because you've grown up hearing that, but you think about how wild that is, that here are the Jews who are in hopeless over here in captivity but for God, and then here comes this king, he defeats the Babylonians, he comes, he says, by the way, you can go home. And this is what happens. As we saw last week, so he issues that decree probably in 538, we saw last week, many Jews returned to Judea at that time, soon thereafter. It would take them some time to prepare for that, and I don't know if they had a favorite time of year they wanted to travel. But in any event, you have a number of Jews who returned, soon thereafter, under the leadership of Sheshbazzar, Zerubbabel, and Joshua the high priest, and they begin to rebuild the temple in 536. They lay the foundation, but they get discouraged because all these people are hassling them and, you know, playing politics with them and all that. So they get discouraged and they stop the work on the temple. They stop all the way down to 520 BC, 16 years. And this is when the prophets Haggai and Zechariah come and stimulate them, encourage them, challenge them to resume the work on the temple. And then the temple is completed in 516, though some would put the date at 515. Now, you had an exodus that came out under Sheshbazzar, Zerubbabel, and Joshua, but a number of Jews chose to stay where they were. Not all the Jews left. A number of them chose to stay where they were, see, content to be a minority group of foreigners in Persian-ruled Mesopotamia. They just stayed there. They were content to be there. After so many decades in Babylonia, they'd carved out a life in that land, and they were sufficiently content that they didn't want to tackle all the uncertainties of making this journey back to Judea. You know, what's going to face us back there? It's been decades. What is life going to be like? That's a long way to go. That would be a killer for me. By the way, get up and hoof 900 miles. I mean, go on. Oh, man. But, so you had a lot of them saying. Now, the book of Esther, it takes place more than 50 years after that return, the initial return of exiles. Okay, and we looked at Ezra. Ezra comes back in 458. So this is before Ezra, but more than 50 years after that initial return of exiles. And the events in Esther, they take place during the reign of the Persian king Xerxes. Okay, he ruled from 486 BC to 465 BC. Now, Xerxes is his more common identification. That the name Xerxes is based on the Greek form of his Persian name, Xerxes. But the Hebrew form of his Persian name, that comes into English as Ahasuerus. Okay, so you have Xerxes is the Greek form of his Persian name. Ahasuerus is the Hebrew form, in English, of his Persian name. But it's the same person. Okay, Xerxes and Ahasuerus are the same person. Now, Esther, as you probably know, it's unusual for a Bible book. It's unusual for a Bible book in the sense that God is never directly mentioned. He's never directly mentioned. On the surface, it reads like a secular story about Jews coping with a particular difficulty while living in Mesopotamia during the Persian Empire. It's just like it just looks like a secular story of what's happening to them there. God is not mentioned directly, and yet without mentioning God, the inspired writer just beautifully implies God's sovereignty and his guiding hand by showing the amazing coincidences that just happened. You see, that's what the writer's doing. He's showing, without naming God, the Jewish people recognize who's the hand behind these things. And so the writer does that. They just come together for the blessing of God's people. And I really think it's important for us to realize that God can be working in our lives to accomplish tremendous things in the future. He can be setting the stage. He can be doing advance work in ways that we don't recognize. You see, he can be doing something here in what appears mundane. But he's doing something that is part of something much larger, but you can't see it. And I think that's an important perspective. God often works quietly, unobtrusively in situations and occurrences that have no apparent connection to anything larger. They just look like the working of daily life. You know, we go over here, do this, I did that, this happened. You know, well, what do you know? He got into this school, this and that, and all that. And all this is just the flow of life. You see, but God is often at work in those kinds of things. See, it's only when we look back on our lives with hindsight that we can see how He has worked in the seemingly mundane, in what we took to be those events just of everyday life. When you look back on them, you look and say, oh, I see how that worked out. I see now. As I look back on, well, when I lost that tin can as a 12-year-old boy, that lid that I used to hit with a stick, when I didn't have a ball or something, I hit it, and when I couldn't find it and prayed to God, I immediately found it. See, what was God doing there? And you look back on things in your life, the seemingly mundane things, and you say, okay, I can see how they come together. See, only then can we see the tapestry that God is weaving in our lives. But you and I are here, and I think if you have the perspective that God is at work in the seemingly mundane, He's doing something. And to me, Esther is terrific for that. Now, the crisis on which the story of Esther hinges, that crisis is given in chapter 3. That's why when I teach Esther, I like to start in chapter 3. I know it's not written that way, but I start in chapter 3. We'll talk about that, and then we'll go back and we'll look at the advance work, because it's in light of that crisis that you really see the advance work there. Well, we're told in chapter 3 that King Xerxes, he elevates one of his nobles. He elevates this guy named Haman above all the other officials. Okay, so this guy's like the king's right-hand man. He gets major altitude. The king has said, Haman's my guy. So he gets elevated that way above all the other officials. Now Haman, it's just interesting, he just happens to be a descendant of Agag, okay, the Amalekite king against whom Israel's king Saul had fought. Back in 1 Samuel 15, some 540 years earlier. So Xerxes elevates this man who just happens to be a descendant of this Amalekite king, Agag. Now, from the time of the Exodus, in the middle of the 15th century BC, from that time, there's been a history of conflict between Israel and the Amalekites. And here you can see in Exodus chapter 17, verse 16, the second part. Moses says, the Lord will be at war against the Amalekites from generation to generation. Israel was charged with blotting out the name of Amalek from under heaven in those texts there. And you see that intermittent conflict with the Amalekites, it dots the biblical record. So here is this guy who's elevated. He's a descendant of this Amalekite king Agag. And King Saul had been instructed to destroy the Amalekites. 1 Samuel chapter 15, he'd been instructed to destroy them, but he disobeyed, you remember. He disobeyed and ultimately was defeated, and he lost his dynasty as a result of that. In 1 Samuel 28, 18. Now this is when Saul came to Samuel, you remember, falsely claiming that he had in fact obeyed the Lord's command to eliminate the Amalekites. He comes there and he says that, and Samuel uttered that great line, what then is this bleating of the sheep in my ears and this lowing of oxen that I hear? You know, I've done it, I've obeyed. What is this I'm hearing? Okay, so this deals with the Amalekites. Now Agag, he's named in a prophetic oracle in Numbers 24:7, given by Balaam. And the text says, his, meaning Israel's king, shall be higher than Agag. And that implies a conflict between Agag, who here may represent the Amalekites generally. But here there's a conflict implied between Israel and Agag, one that will end in Israel's favor. So I want you to see when the writer points out that Haman is an Agagite, it's not just thrown out. It may be as we read it, we think, okay, Agagite. Right. There's a lot of stuff packed into that little phrase there. Now, Mordecai is a Jew living in Susa, which here is called Shushan, But to just give you an idea, here we are over here. You see Jerusalem, Samaria over here. This is where the Persian Empire, they were a big deal. But he's living in Susa. Mordecai's a Jew living there. He's probably a member of the king's court. And he refuses to kneel before Haman and to pay Haman honor. Haman has been elevated above all the nobles. Everybody you would expect when this guy comes out, we're going to bow before him. We're going to pay him that honor. We're going to pay him that respect. Haman refuses to do that. Now, Mordecai refuses to do that to Haman. And as it happens, Mordecai is a Benjamite from the clan of Kish, the father of King Saul. Now, there are people that say, no, this is a different Kish. This is a Kish further down. I don't think that's right. Okay? They're trying to solve a problem with that, and I think there are other ways to solve that problem. Okay? In chapter 2. But I think this is when you get this Agagite, and then you get Kish and Shammai there. No, I think we're going back to Kish, okay, the father of Saul, and it's identifying Mordecai on the side of this ongoing battle that has been happening between the Jews and the Amalekites. Now, this long-standing hostility between Israel and the Amalekites, see, that's probably, at least from Mordecai's perspective, why he refused to honor Haman. I think that is what is at work. Is he says, no, I'm not going to bow before this Amalekite who's a perpetual enemy of the people of God. That God has said, blot them out. Okay, I think that's what is at work. I don't think it's that he thought bowing down to somebody would somehow be a violation of the first commandment, no other gods, or the second commandment about no idols. You see, I mean, you see Jews willing to bow down in honor of somebody. You see that in a lot of places. That's different, you see, from the notion of worshiping an idol in Daniel chapter 3. They're not going to do that, at least they shouldn't. But just to bow down in terms of paying honor and respect to somebody, they have no objection to doing that. And you see this in a number of places, Genesis 33:3, 1 Samuel 20, 41, 24, 8, and I could go on. Okay, why is he resisting? I think it's this history that goes on there. Now, when Haman learns of Mordecai's snub, and he learns that he's a Jew, at least the other people knew he was a Jew, but he learns of this snub and learns that he's a Jew, well, he's just furious. So that suggests to me that he's also tuned into this hostility. You say, well, how can people carry hostility between people? Have you seen how the Palestinians and Jews go at it? I remember, Geraldo was being interviewing one of these guys years ago, these Palestinian guys, and the guy said he started to think that Geraldo was Jewish. Are you a Jew? You see, that would be huge. Why? Just because of this racial thing, you see. But he winds up here, so we have here, he learns that of this snub. They're told, they said, you know, this guy's not kneeling or bowing before you, not paying you honor. And he's furious. He then goes and he convinces the king. He convinces Xerxes. Okay, he goes in there and convinces him to allow him to decree in the king's name that on a particular day, all the Jews in the kingdom are to be annihilated. So he goes in, you think, oh, how's that going to happen? Look, these guys, like I said, they have power. And this is his number one man. And so his number one man comes in there and he convinces the king. He says, look, let me decree in your name on a particular day, it's open season on the Jews in the kingdom. So he lets him do that. So it's kind of like a law that says on November 15th, all Chinese in America, sorry, Mr. Monk, all Chinese in America are to be killed. It would be like that. So we have this decree on a certain day, all the Jews are going to be killed. Well, chapter 3, it sets the crisis. That's the crisis, that's the hinge of the book. But it's the coming of that crisis, you see, that reveals the significance of God's advance work. What God had been doing before that you wouldn't recognize. You wouldn't recognize the significance of it until you get to this, but then you go, wow. You see? And I'm trying to get you to see that's how life is. You see, and if you can hold that idea, it fills even the mundane with the potential work of God. You see? And it takes these things as you're doing. You may be laboring somewhere and thinking, what am I doing? This is like a drag. I don't doubt it may be a drag. Okay? But there may be something going on, see? There may be, I launch into a story about Brother John getting into the University of Florida despite all odds, and he's told that story before, but I'll paint the picture here with Esther and let this story do it. God's advance work, you see, we have here, it's reported in chapters 1 and 2, long before Haman was exalted by King Xerxes to this position that allowed him entree to the king, that allowed him to get the king to agree that in your name I can issue this decree that all the Jews are going to be killed on a certain day. Long before he was elevated to that position, it just so happened that Mordecai had this incredibly attractive cousin whom he had raised as a daughter after her parents died. This young woman's name was Hadassah, but she's also known by the name Esther. So he has this incredibly attractive cousin, and it just so happened, this is long before, it just so happened that Queen Vashti refused a command from King Xerxes to appear before him during a great banquet he was hosting for his officials and servants. Now, it's quite likely, by the way, that this banquet that he was hosting, this was a war council in 483 BC that he was hosting. And what would happen is we would bring all the officials from all over parts of the empire because he's planning an attack on Greece. And what he wants to do is to have this tremendous banquet that goes on for months where he displays the power and majesty of the Persian Empire so that all the people will be on board and committed and down for the struggle that we're going to launch against Greece. Okay, so it has a political aspect to it. It's not simply I'm having this banquet, although these guys would do all kinds of things. But I think that's an important thing to grasp. But he summons her in that context, wanting her to display part of this great glory of the Persian Empire, and she says, I'm not coming. Well, you can see this puts him in a tough spot. First of all, it humiliates him in this very setting where he's trying to marshal support. He wants to show the glory of the kingdom, bring in the beautiful queen and this kind of thing, and I'm not coming. Now, it doesn't say this, but I suspect, you know, having been, before I was a Christian, I knew alcohol a time or two, and she was throwing a party here, so I smell the influence of alcohol in this. Now, that doesn't say that. When she refuses, she's hosting a banquet, you see in chapter 1, verse 9, it sounds to me like maybe she's loaded. Okay, that'd be the kind of thing that somebody loaded would do. The king summons you. I don't care what the king wants. Tell the king to drop dead. Okay? That's not in the text. I'm just giving you between the lines. But in any event, for whatever reason, he summons her. She says, buzz off. He's humiliated. You know, it's interfering with what he's trying to do for a larger thing. So Vashti, he orders that she be banished from his presence and a kingdom-wide search be begun for a replacement. Now, out of all the young women in Xerxes' kingdom, it just so happened that Esther was the one chosen queen to replace Vashti. That just happened. You see, it just, you know, that's a very pleasant coincidence that she was chosen out of all of the women. And by the way, this is several years later. In between, Xerxes has gone and launched this attack on Greece. So this is some 4 years after the banquet. But in any event, she becomes the queen. She happened to have the qualities that set her apart from all the others in the eyes of Xerxes. So she becomes queen, and it just so happened that Mordecai, who was probably in the king's court as a result of Esther having become queen, it just so happened that he's in a position to learn that two of the king's eunuchs planned to kill the king. You know, he just happened to be overhear them. He just happened to be in a position to do that. He passed that information on to the king by way of Esther. The king was able to verify Mordecai's tip that, yes, in fact, these clowns were trying to kill me. And then he had the conspirators executed. And the last clause of chapter 2, verse 23 says, and it was recorded in the book of the Chronicles in the presence of the king. That will come up later. You see, he happened to hear that, tells the king, king verifies it, kills those people, saves him from this possible assassination, and it gets recorded. Okay, it gets recorded. Now, all of these things were important parts of God's working on behalf of his people, his performing of this tremendous rescue that we're going to see in the book, but none would have been recognized as such until after the fact. You just wouldn't see. You see, at this point, focusing here, it's until you can go back and look. You see, it's when you go back and look at what is going on here. And that's when we look back on our lives, as I've said, that's when you can see this most clearly. Now, Mordecai, he urges Esther to go into the king's presence to beg for mercy and plead with him for his people. This is in chapter 4. This is red alert. We've got a guy who set a date when all the genocide, the Jews are going to get killed. And so he says, listen, you got to go in and beg the king. You're the queen. I mean, you got an in. You're going to have to go and beg. I don't care what you have to do. You're going to do something. Because this is code red, baby. We're going to get killed. And he says that to her. And she's, you know, you got to go in there. And at this point, see, the king doesn't know that Esther's a Jew. She'd kept that quiet at Mordecai's instruction. It's not really clear why, you see, but Mordecai had her keep that quiet. So the king doesn't know at this point that Esther's a Jew. And Esther initially balks at the idea. She balks at the idea because she had not been summoned into the king's presence. And that's what I've said, you know, I think last week. Anybody who went into the king's presence without having been summoned was killed. That's it. The only exception would be is if you came into his presence uninvited and then he held out a scepter. That's him saying, okay, even though I didn't invite you, I'm giving you a pass. Okay? Because, you see, this is the sense of kingship. You don't just sashay into the king's presence. See, the king represents the nation. You don't just go cruising in there like, you know, he's just like an average Joe. Now, that's, see, in America, we're so egalitarian, that seems nuts. Okay? But this is how it was. And so he wasn't an average Joe. He was the king. And so she hesitates at this because she says, listen, you know, this is the way it works with the king, and I haven't been invited into his presence. And then Mordecai sends the following words back to her in chapter 4, verse 13 and 14. Very famous. It says, then Mordecai told them to reply to Esther, do not think to yourself that in the king's palace you will escape any more than all the other Jews. For if you keep silent at this time, relief and deliverance will rise for the Jews from another place, but you and your father's house will perish. And who knows whether you've not come to the kingdom for such a time as this. You see, he's pointing her to the fact, do you see all of this work that's been going on? Do you think that this may be God has brought you right to this position in your life just for this reason? Just so you can exercise the influence that you have. You see, one cannot ignore the will of God with impunity. It may appear to Esther that she can ignore her responsibility, a responsibility that's made clear from the circumstances. You see, God's people are on the verge of getting annihilated in Persia, and so that creates a responsibility for somebody in a position to do something, or to try to do something. And so the point is that she can't ignore that responsibility and escape unharmed. Mordecai tells her if she's thinking otherwise, that she's deluding herself. Because she's not going to escape. She's going to wind up getting punished as well, she and her family. Now, though God has set the table for deliverance, right? He has set the table for deliverance in that she is there in this position, but Esther still must choose to act. And that's how it is in our lives. We sometimes wonder, well, why doesn't God just do this? Why doesn't God do this in some way that doesn't require courageous conviction from me? He's in control. He can do that. Why does he have to put Esther in a position where she has to go and act with courageous devotion? Well, you can ask him when you see him, but this is how he works. Why does he have somebody go to battle and face these psychopaths? Why doesn't he just strike them all dead? Well, he can strike them dead sometimes when that suits what he wants to do. Otherwise, he'll tell you, no, you got to go and fight these slathering psychopaths. You go into battle with them, and the victory will be yours. But you don't get the victory by sitting here and saying, slay them. He says, you go fight them. Okay, so this is important. You see, in seeing how God works and in Christian living, you see, so here he set the table. Now, if she doesn't do, she has to do what she can, and she has to use it's like stewardship of your life situation. Let me put it that way. She's been brought to a position where she has an opportunity, and as somebody who serves God, she has a responsibility to use her situation and circumstance for God's glory. Now, the question that she has to ask, you see, if she doesn't do that, Mordecai says God will bring deliverance from somewhere else. He's convinced of that. He's just seen the Jews waltz, well, decades earlier, but they all, what, decree? We're out. So he says, if you don't do this, God's going to protect us in some other way. Okay, God's going to do that in some other way. But that's not the question before her. The question before her is, will she act with courageous devotion? Will she be a steward of her life circumstance and act in a way that glorifies God? That's the question that's pressing on her, you see. And as you and I face opportunities in our lives, opportunities to influence people for God, we need to remember that you and I may have come to that position for such a time as that, right? You and I may be in that position. God has given us that opportunity with family, with friends, with brothers and sisters in Christ that we have some influence with. You don't have influence with many people. I don't know if that's dawned on you, but you don't. There are circles of people that who really will hear you. And there's an ocean of people who don't care a thing about what you think. Okay? So you are in circumstances and situations. I've said many times, Brother John led me to Christ. I don't know if there was another person that could have done that. He and I have always been close like this our whole lives. And God brought him to Christ, by the way, through his getting into the University of Florida, where he was converted and then he came and pestered me. But see, that's the kind of thing. You see, just other people, I would have blown them off. But I couldn't do that with him. That's the kind of thing. All of us have situations and circumstances like that in our lives that we need to use those circumstances, the influence we have, to help other people, to influence them in God-glorifying ways. Okay, Esther asked Mordecai to have all the Jews in Susa to join her and her maids in a 3-day fast, during which time they're no doubt praying. But this 3-day fast, and she says when that's done, then she's going to go in before the king. But she wants to pray first, because she knows this is life and death. And I think that's just really something. It speaks volumes to me about humbling oneself before God and calling out for His strength and His intercession in times of difficulty. We face all kinds of difficulties in our lives, right? We face all kinds of difficulties in our lives, but how often do we devote ourselves to prayer regarding those circumstances? We'll complain. We'll read self-help books. We'll take pills. We'll do all kinds of stuff. But how often do we earnestly beseech God in our lives? And I see this here. I just am impressed by it, that here's a real situation. First thing is, I need to have people praying. I want people fasting and praying because I'm getting ready to go into a life and death situation. I don't think prayer is some nonsense. I don't think I just sit there, well, can't do anything about it. All you can do is pray. Okay, yeah, well, yeah, that means you can't do anything. Right? You hear that? You hear people say that. But the prayer of a righteous man is powerful and effective. I read that somewhere, you see. And so she understands that, and we all face those kinds of things, and I think it's important. Okay, the deliverance in chapters 5 to 10. All right, Esther approached the king, and it just so happened that he received her. Could have killed her, but he didn't. Scepter, hey, good to see you. All right? So rather than make her request at that time, she asked that the king and Haman, that they come to a banquet that she's prepared. You see, this is a thing where she's going to express her, I don't know, her just love, and it's just a thing that you do as a sign of, listen, I really appreciate you, and all these kind of, come to a banquet. And then, I'll tell you what I want then. But first, let me express to you, what I think of you and all this kind of thing. All right, so she says she's going to have a banquet there. And at the banquet, their banquet says, okay, we're having this banquet. All right, so what's up? And she says, look, why don't you return the next day? I got another banquet. One banquet's not good enough for you. I got this banquet. You come tomorrow for another banquet, and I promise you that I will give you my request at that time. Okay, so we got another banquet. Now, so the king is between banquets. So Haman and Xerxes are at Esther's banquet. What's up? Now let's come back tomorrow. So in between, the night between these two banquets, you see, it just so happened that the king had insomnia. He couldn't sleep. Okay, I understand that. So the king had insomnia, it just so happened. But it just so happened that he ordered the record of his reign to be read to him. Well, that put anybody to sleep. But he says, I can't sleep, so here, come read me the record of my reign. And it just so happened that the record of Mordecai's reporting the assassination plot, let's open up the scrolls, let's read. Well, here, it just so happened that they land on Mordecai. And so they read about Mordecai reporting the assassination plot, and the king then learns that nothing had been done to honor Mordecai. That's 5 minutes, right? Okay. All right. So nothing had been done to honor Mordecai, and then right at that moment, who comes in but Haman? So the king is just, what? Nothing was done to honor this man who saved my life? That's crazy. Well, we got to rectify that. Soon as that happens, in comes Haman. Now, Haman's coming in. He's going to talk to Xerxes about having Mordecai hanged on the gallows he's built for that purpose. So he's going in there. He wants to make sure he's got the king's okay. Got these big gallows. I want you. You're okay. I'm going to hang this guy. Okay? Is that fine with you? So that's why he's there. He's coming in to get the king's permission, but he never gets the chance to ask permission to kill Mordecai, because the king immediately says to Haman what he thinks the king should do for somebody who's super special. What do you think I should do for somebody who's just, blow your socks off special? Oh, so naturally Haman thinks, what? Who else could that be? He's talking about me. You see, he's talking about me. So he says, look, I think you should put your robe on the guy. You should have the noblest prince lead him through the city on the king's horse, shouting, this is what is done for the man the king delights to honor. Your robe, your horse, your top noble, walking this guy around going, you see this? This is what's done for the man the king desires to honor. So that's his advice. Well, the king loves the idea. And he sends Haman out immediately to lead Mordecai through the city square on the king's horse, proclaiming before him, thus shall it be done to the man whom the king delights to honor. Now, do you not see God in that? Do you not see God in that? Well, Haman's utterly depressed and mortified when he tells his wife and friends, the same people, by the way, who earlier had counseled him to build the gallows and to tell the king to have Mordecai hanged on it. Well, they now tell him, if Mordecai, before whom you've begun to fall, if he's of the Jewish people, which they knew he was, they say, but if he's of the Jewish people, you will not overcome him, but will surely fall before him. You see, they knew he was a Jew, but when they saw this amazing reversal, where the very person he's going to ask the king for permission to kill, he winds up in an eye, bat of an eye, leading through the city, proclaiming his greatness, they say, ooh, I see somebody's hand in this. And so then they're convinced that God is with the Jewish people. And so since you're after this guy, you're toast. Okay? That's kind of how counselors that you have here. See, they were telling him one thing over here, and then they turn around and go, hey, we were wrong. It's not us, it was you. You see, we were wrong. But he winds up. So at the second banquet, Esther asked the king to spare her people, people who'd been targeted for destruction by Haman. And needless to say, the king is not pleased, and he has Haman hanged on the very gallows he had prepared for hanging Mordecai. You see that little twist of fate there, right? So he has him do that. And I also like the line in here after, once this is told, when Esther says, it's this wicked Haman who's doing all this stuff. King's going, what king's so mad? He goes out. Once the king is angry with you, you know, this is not good. So I tell you, see, there's no habeas corpus, there's no due process, there's none of this stuff. When the king is angry with you, you're toast. So king goes out, and he goes over and tries to plead with Esther. King comes in and goes, what, are you going to jump on the queen when I step out? What are you doing? All right, so then he knows, you know, he's toast, and he is taken out, and he's hanged. Now, the moral, as I see it, is, you know, you don't mess with God. You see, you don't mess with God. And since no law of the Persians could be revoked, the king authorized issuance of a decree because, you know, they're still in this bind. What's going to happen? You can't reverse this thing that you can, that you're going to be able to kill the people, the command that you go out and kill all of the Jews in the Persian Empire on that certain day. So what do they do? He says, well, here's what we'll do. We'll issue another decree. This decree will allow you to go kill the people trying to kill you. And I'll be fine with that. In other words, it's not me saying, okay, you guys go kill them, and if anybody messes with you and stops that, well, then we'll come and kill them for you. No. I'm saying now, you go fight for yourselves. All right, well, now it's war. That's a different story than me just going slaughter you. Okay, very different story. So that's how it winds up being handled. And on that day, the Jews completely reversed their fortune, wound up slaughtering their enemies. I heard that bell. And this is the origin of the Jewish festival of Purim, which is on the 13th and 14th of Adar, which that corresponds to February and March. And the name of that festival, Purim, it comes from this Akkadian word, Puru, which is the lot. And it was the lot that Haman cast to determine the day when they would annihilate the Jews. And so Purim comes from that word, lot, and it refers to those that day that he picked. So this is still celebrated by Jewish people, by the way. This tremendous rescue, this deliverance. But what I want you to see, above all, is God's working in ways that is not always obvious, but he's working, I'm telling you. You saw him working. Was he working in those things? Yes, he was. Would it have been obvious? No, it would not. But then it comes obvious. So you look back on your life. Even now, think about that. All of the places God has put his fingers to divert the stream in your life that has brought you to this point. He works powerfully. Okay, I'm through. Thanks.